concerned for making life better for ordinary humans must be the chief objective of science. Never forget this while you are pondering over your diagrams and equations. This was said by the great scientist Albert Einstein, even though a theoretical physicist, while addressing the student body of Caltech at US. Welcome to a new episode of Asianet News Science Talk, and get ready to experience the research and projects of a great Indian scientist which have profound impact on our society. Our guest today is Professor A.G. Ramakrishnan, who heads the Medical Intelligence and Language Engineering Lab at IISc Bengaluru. He enjoys applying academical research to solve real-world issues, especially those of the marginalized sections of our society. He is joining us now from IISc Bengaluru. Professor Ramakrishnan, welcome to Asianet News Science Talk.
Thanks, Alni, for this amazing quote from Albert Einstein. I really liked it.
So most of the research and the technologies you developed have great societal impact. And the most admiring one is your project, The Gift of New Abilities for the Visually Challenged People. Please share more details of this project and the technology you invented for this.
Thank you for this question. Basically, I wanted the visually challenged people to be able to access every reading material that the rest of us are able to access. I also wanted the technology to be affordable. We designed state-of-the-art quality printed text recognition systems that work on images taken by the cheapest flatbed scanners available in the market, because we thought people will be using whatever is the cheapest available in the market. So we didn't want to use, you know, expensive, very accurate scanners. And from the beginning, we worked on very old printed books. And I told my students and research staff that this is not just a research project for publishing, but this will be a tool that should be used out in the world by common men. So with this system, we converted about 600 printed books in Tamil mainly, and also a little bit in Kannada, and which were used by hundreds of blind students, which gave us the Manthan Award, South Asia and Asia Pacific in 2014. Working with such rigorous and real constraints also gave us two patents. Since the braille paper was imported and the braille books are very expensive, so we developed text-to-speech conversion systems with which people can listen to the book rather than reading the braille book. So for this work, we got the Manthan Award again in 2015, and my student Shivakumar got the Gandhian and Technological Innovation Award at the Rashtrapati Bhavan.
Which technology you used for this, sir? Did you invent that technology or it's available technology?
I am an applied scientist. I have used the tools and we have studied the tools extensively to find out which is best used at where. And so it is not a new technology. Things like this already existed for English, but we specialized in the sense that we looked at what is the real problem. The real problem is segmenting the individual characters. Very old books, you know, either the characters are all merging because ink has flowed, or because of time, you know, there is a lot of fading and the characters have got cut. So the system which is trained on regular characters, when they encounter this, they cannot recognize it because they are either broken characters or merged characters. So we developed some new methods to take care of this thing, to merge the broken characters or break the merged characters. And we actually patented that. That patent also has been given. So we did more innovations in looking at what is the real problem and solving it, not necessarily the recognition problem. We did a lot of work on the background problem of how to improve the, you know, binarization of the paper, the text, and how to segment the individual lines, especially in Kannada, you know, you have the, what they call in Tamil also we call uttru, that is the half consonants come below the line and they are put in already arbitrary places in old books. So even what is one line ending and another line starting is not easy, unlike it is in English. So we did a lot of innovations in those things.
What's the name of the technology you used?
It's basically called optical character recognition. We gave different names for our OCRs in Tamil and this thing.
How much time you take to take a braille copy of a 500 page text?
See, roughly our OCR takes around 2.5 seconds per page, madam. So, see, there are now scanners available, which are not again expensive, around 40,000 rupees for the scanner purpose. It is good. So you take an entire book, remove the binding and feed it, and this can scan that entire book of, let's say, 100 or 200 pages in 1 or 2 minutes. And that gives a, you know, what is called a TIFF image. And that image you directly feed into our OCR, and it can do all the OCRs of all the pages and dump the text in a matter of few minutes.
Any application of AI in this?
Artificial intelligence, what do you mean by that? Whatever the man can do, the machine can do, they called it artificial intelligence. So we can read the book, we can recognize the characters, we can also convert into speech. So now the machine is doing it. So we can do it as artificial intelligence, but exact technology varies widely. There are too many things involved in this.
So what are the merits you see for your method when compared to those of Google and CDAC?
It is very fast. Second, because of the way we have trained it, you know, it works on most of the text. And most importantly, people don't want the OCR, not just the recognition system. They want solutions. Say, if you go to a blind person, you know, he wants a brain book or an audio book. Or you go to an author, you know, we have digitized now around 2,000 Kannada books and convert them to e-books. The authors don't want to buy OCRs and use it. They want to give their books and convert into e-books, which can be directly read in the thing. So there are so many things that go around with that. No OCR gives you 100%. So always there is some manual correction involved in putting back the images. So we worked constantly with the organizations which are working for the blind people and developed tools that will increase the productivity of the people who do this. So now if you give me a book, I can convert this into 3 days into an e-book that can be read on any digital device.
That's great, sir. Can you give a brief account of how much of the students benefited from this? Can you give some examples?
See, one person I'll tell you, very unique, this thing. See, we think that they are challenged, but sometimes they are much more resourceful than us. There was one guy who came from Mandya on the way to Mysore, and this guy is completely blind and he is working in a port for some work, and then he took our OCR and text-to-speech, and he said he is using it himself on his laptop, and he wanted a few improvements, and we did it and gave it, and he says, you know, he uses the OCR to recognize the text on the newspaper, converts it into speech and puts it on his mobile. Every day when he travels by bus from home to the court, he listens to it on his mobile. So, you know, this is the uniqueness with which we work is, we want to really deliver solutions to people the way they want. So we have, at every level, we have been working with actual users and trying to develop our technology that will optimize the productivity for them.
Great, sir. Sir, any plan to include Malayalam text also in future? Currently, your project in Tamil and Kannada. Any plan to include Malayalam also?
We don't plan to develop the Malayalam technology because ultimately, like I told you, you know, you don't care whether I developed the OCR or Google developed the OCR or somebody else developed it, right? You want the solution. Suppose you are an author, you want your book to be converted. You are not bothered really about, you know, which part of the technology is developed by whom. So now partly we are also using Google's OCR, and then IIIT Hyderabad, there is a Malayali professor, Jawahar, who is working on Malayalam OCRs, and whenever it is developed, recently they contacted us whether we can use their OCR. So we'll be testing that, and if it is good, we'll be using it. We can actually now do this in almost all Indian languages.
Another interesting one is the scientific study of the impact of pranayama. So can you give more details about this project?
Basically, I'm interested in health. Personally, I found that pranayama, that is breathing, is at least 10 times more impactful for our health than diet. We know many people, you know, even our prime minister goes on diet for the Navaratri, people don't eat at all during, you know, Shivaratri or Ekadasi days, and they're still alive. But if you stop breathing for one day, for whatever reason, then your brain will be dead. The brain will be, brain cells will be dead if we don't get oxygen for 6 continuous minutes. So that important is that. And we eat only maybe 3 to 4 times a day, whereas we breathe 24/7, even when I'm sleeping, even when somebody is in coma. So even if there is an improvement of 5% in the way we breathe and the way we get oxygen, I found that it is very useful. When you do symmetric breathing, that is, you control the timing so that the inhalation and exhalation are almost equal, then that is able to drive the brain electrical activity. In other words, brain's electrical activity is called the EEG, synchronizes with your breathing, the phases of the breathing. This is an amazing thing. And also, people have, that not our work, people have published that breathing is able to modulate the velocity of the cerebrospinal fluid, which is the equivalent of blood in the brain. And every time we inhale, the heart rate increases, and every time we exhale, heart rate decreases. So sitting in one place, doing a deep breathing, you can give an enormously good exercise for your heart. So this is where I found that by practicing pranayama and you know, some meditation, I completely cured myself of my hypertension, for which I was taking medicines for 9.5 years, and the past 5 years I have completely stopped. That increased my curiosity, and that is how I got into this field. I feel a lot more research has to be done on breathing, and it has enormous benefits. And this should be also taught in schools. I am writing a small chapter for a science book, and I convinced once the school in Chennai, they are going to introduce that for the 9th standard students next year.
During pranayama, we hold our breath for some seconds.
Yeah.
So what is the effect of holding the breath on the brain or our cardiovascular system?
What is already known is that, I already told you, you know, respiratory sinus arrhythmia, with inhalation heart rate increases, exhalation heart rate decreases. Nobody has studied what happens during the breath hold. We did systematic studies. You inhale for some time, hold for some time, exhale for some time, and again equal time you hold. That means there is a symmetric breathing with this breath hold interspersed between inhalation and exhalation, and again we have inhalation and exhalation. And to our surprise, we found that when you are doing that at low breathing rates, the heart rate is fluctuating even during the breath hold. So interestingly, we found that the heart rate fluctuation is independently controlled by an area of the brain, which also controls the breathing rate. So you are maintaining a particular rate in spite of breathing, holding the breath in between. So it continues to change the heart rate. So we published this, and people were surprised, you know, about this this thing, and they asked us, what is the mechanism? Say, I'm not a biologist, so I don't know the mechanism, but it is very interesting that even when you are holding the breath, the heart rate is fluctuating. And like I said, very few people have studied this, so I cannot say more about it, but I'm interested in studying much more about it, because the pranayama texts say that the emphasis of pranayama is on the breath hold, what they call kumbhaka, rather than the inhalation exhalation. So that makes it more interesting to study more.
In some kind of pranayama, we can see that they exhale with great pressure, and saying that it will give more impact on our cognitive abilities. Is it true?
See, normally when you inhale, exhale without our own knowledge, we never fill the lungs completely, nor do we completely exhaust the air inside. There is always some air remaining in the lungs. But with this forceful exhalation, you can almost breathe out the entire carbon dioxide in the system. And so you are filling your body with more of the oxygen. And oxygen is the primary resource for brain. You know, the brain has a weight of only 2% of the body, but it takes 20% of the oxygen. So I assume that when you flush it with fresh oxygen and remove this thing, probably it, you know, wakes up and does better these cognitive activities.
During the COVID pandemic, you published a remarkable research paper, that is, there is problems in the air conditioning of IC units. So what are your observations, sir?
See, we have to look at two, three different things. Why were the ICUs designed? See, suppose I go through a surgery, then they want to protect me from infection coming from outside. Somebody who is entering the ICU may have infection, or when you keep the door open, you know, there may be some infection. That was the purpose for which they wanted to protect me inside a closed room. But in the case of COVID, is it the right place? Because in the case of COVID patients, they are the source of infection. Literature says that when a person is breathing out, when he is a COVID patient, millions of virus come in every exhalation. And you put 10 of them in an ICU, so the viral load inside the room will go up like anything. And they are in a recirculating air conditioning room. Absolutely, air conditioning is not required for these patients. After all, I'm already struggling for breathing. I would rather be, you will keep me in a better, ventilated and warm room rather than a cool room. I personally feel that many patients died because of this unfavorable conditions. And you know, more than 10,000 doctors and nurses died around the world. I mentioned that it is mainly because of this, because they are exposed to viral load. It will be much better to keep them in open tents where the air comes and goes. See, most important thing is you need to continuously flush the air, because every time as a COVID patient when I exhale, I release millions of this virus into the air. So if you give me a mask, then the mask will keep all my exhaled virus within myself. So that will increase my own viral load. And if you put me in a recirculating air conditioning room where, you know, hardly 10 to 15% new fresh air can come, and an air conditioning engineer told me in a hospital that most of the time they even reduce that because doctors say, you know, I want cool. So they reduce the fresh air further. So this is, if people really studied what is the viral load inside ICUs, they will be shocked, I'm sure. I have not done it, but NDTV interviewed me on this. And they also had a doctor on that thing. And the doctor agreed, yes, air conditioning is not really needed. It is more for the comfort of the doctor. But later, when I asked for the video, they refused to give it. They have not also put it outside. So there are other interests in that. Unfortunately, nothing has happened. I again hear that patients are dying in Kerala. If only they are put outside these kind of recirculating air-conditioned rooms, more doctors, more patients, more nurses will be alive.
Yes, more deaths occurred in ICU.
Definitely. You look at any other disease, you know, heart failure or heart attack or anything else, there will be more people dying when they are driving, when they are at home, they are doing something else. But in COVID, all people died only in the hospitals.
What are your suggestions? That is, we need separate ICUs for surgical patients and the infection.
For this reason, ideally, you don't need AC because they are not having any open wounds or anything, right? In fact, if you know that, you know, they used to ask us to wash our hands because through intact skin also, it is not coming out or going in. So you can just put them into a simple room where, you know, there is continuously air is sucked out. So that constantly air is being, you know, pumped into the room and flushed out. That is good enough. And I can breathe better also if there is no cold. You don't need any AC. You don't need any special equipment. And even oxygen can be provided in any, because you know people who have problems with oxygen, they give even oxygen at home. So you really don't need an AC at all for this.
So anyone of the authorities listen to your suggestions? Any step taken?
I talked to some doctors. They said, you know, we go by protocols. We cannot change anything. I don't have the power to talk to these things. But people like you may, you know, increase the sensitivity of, you know, the authorities. And then if somebody wants to talk to me or they don't do analysis inside ICUs, the viral load when patients are there, they will come to know and do something.
So after publishing this research paper, did ICMR notice this?
In fact, I talked to some people in National Medical Commission. They all agreed that whatever I wrote is perfectly correct. At least you brought it out, they said.
Another important work is using AI to automate conventional sleep test. So what is the new method you invented for this?
Once again, here we did not invent any new method, madam. Honestly, what we did, see, our this thing is to give the best solution to the doctors and patients together. So, because thousands of papers have been already published in sleep staging. So, my bright student Ritika, who is now working in IITM Extension in Zanzibar, immediately after her PhD, they taught her. So, I want a thing that works across patients, across data sets. Even if you train it with only normal people, it should work on, you know, patients with sleep disorders and so on. So she took 7 of the standard databases having, you know, this kind of data. And we looked at all the techniques people used, all the signals that people used, and we made extensive analysis and found out what is the best signal for classifying between two stages. Let us say, you know, deep sleep stage 1 and 2. Or REM and, you know, N1, things like that. So we used electroencephalogram brain signal. We used electrooculogram, the eyes muscle signal. And then we used electromyogram, which is a muscle in the chin. So, and we looked at all the features that, hundreds of features people have come up with. All of that we implemented. And it implemented an algorithm to find out what are the best 100 features which you can use from each of those modalities. And for each of those, we had a multiple level recognition system. At each level, we found out what is the best signal, what is the best features. And we also used other things such as, you know, contextual information and all that. And we exceeded the results published by anybody in the literature on all those 7 data sets. And you can train it on patients and test it on normals and or test it on, train it on normals and test it on patients. All of that we have done. So it's what I would say is a comprehensive solution that we came up, which you can apply on unknown patients. Because many of the literature, they train on some data of the patient and test on the remaining data of the same patients, not on new patients or not on some other database. Because when you record EEG in one hospital here, in Bangalore and one in Trivandrum, for example, you may use different settings, different machines. So it should work across all the data sets. That's our thing. And this has been now accepted in IEEE Journal of Biomedical Health Informatics. I hope, you know, I plan to release that code in a way that doctors can use. I hope some people will try it and see how better it is compared to what is already.
And your method is faster also. Yeah. Compared to the conventional methods?
That I have not tested, madam, but it works on any desktop computers. And again, you know, you can analyze a whole night data within few minutes.
Also, you developed a neural network study for early diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease, a paper I saw, and then mini mental state examination score using spontaneous speech.
Yeah. So this is actually an offshoot of our work. It's not our primary research. See, during COVID, we could not collect data and do something. So I had 2 students who were working on different aspects of speech. One was working on speaker recognition. Given, you know, speech of many people, you have to recognize who's. And the other one was working on Sanskrit speech recognition. So both of these people came to me, you know, we are not able to collect data because of COVID, there are a lot of restrictions and so on. We believe in collecting our own data for most of these things. Then I said, let us work on something else. And this challenge was announced by one of the conferences, so I asked them to work. So it's kind of a different work we did. And the results were not extraordinary. We just exceeded the basic result that they gave. But later, I asked them to work, see, because like you rightly said, we worked on spontaneous speech. That means whatever speech we record from those patients. But later we also looked at the text that is transcribed from the speech. And we got much better results. But let me tell you, you know, most of these biomedical researchers, these are good in paper, not much useful. Because if you are just recognizing Alzheimer's or any disease from normal people, see, that does not prove anything, because when a patient comes, he will not say, please check whether I have Alzheimer's. They will have some, this thing, you know, some memory problem. That memory problem could be due to so many other things, you know, or some other. So the same symptoms can come from multiple diseases. So we need actually differential diagnosis. I need to take data from multiple patients with multiple diseases, all of which can give rise to similar symptoms. And then I should be able to isolate that is this disease and not any other disease. That is what is really useful research. Unfortunately, most of this research, you know, sometimes I tell my students that it's not very useful, you should know that, but, you know, we need to survive publishing it. So be clear that why you're, what you're doing is really useful, like Einstein said, or, you know, you're just doing it to survive, get your degree. Sometimes you have to do that.
In all your researches, mainly your tool is artificial intelligence. What's your opinion about artificial intelligence? Is it our friend, companion, or it will be a threat in future?
See, I remember when computers were introduced, you know, when I was in high school or early college, I don't remember. All the bank employees went on strike. They thought, you know, their jobs will be useful. So any new thing, people are worried what it will do. The same thing, dynamite can be used for, you know, blasting this thing to get stones, or dynamite can be used for destructive purpose. Atomic energy can be used for producing power, which we are doing very much, or it can be used to destroy corrosion. So the tools or technologies by themselves, they don't have a soul, they don't have a mind, they don't think. It is the mind and the soul of the person who is using the technology. So what is really needed is to educate humanity for better use of whatever technology we have. And artificial intelligence also is the same thing. It is an extraordinary technology. We can use it for many things. But we have to be very careful in what we ultimately use here to put it to. And some of the issues that people have raised, it also because the data, as you know, artificial intelligence is heavily dependent on a lot of data, annotated data. And when you give biased data, then obviously the system is going to give biased information, because it does not, even though you think it is artificially thinking, no. It's based on the algorithm that many human beings, many PhDs have designed. So whatever logic they have given is what it is going to use. And whatever data with the annotation that the labels that they have given, it is going to learn from that. So if the annotation that I have given is biased, suppose I say that, you know, black people are less intelligent, and that is how I have labeled it, then it will automatically say that. So the artificial intelligence or the tools or the robots by themselves are neither good nor bad. It is me.
It depends on the people who use it.
Exactly. And so we need to, but with more and more powerful technology, it becomes more and more important to educate humanity to act in an ecocentric thinking. All the problems arise in the world because of egocentric thinking.
You are a professor in electrical engineering, but all your researches are in medical field. How this transformation occurred?
So I did my ABE and M.Tech in electronics and communication engineering. So electrical includes, you know, if you go to IIT Madras, you know, they have only electrical engineering department. They don't have separate electronics and communication. So it all included. We have separate departments, but there's no restriction on what you work on. So during when I went for PhD, there was a very famous professor, you know, I liked him personally, you know. He was also interested in working on real life problems, and he was working closely with doctors. So I did not even apply for electrical engineering and I applied for PhD. I only applied for biomedical engineering, which was part of a different department. So that is where I went, and he used to send us to hospitals. We were in hospital for entire few days to look at different departments, cardiology and so on, to know what is going on and know the real issues of them. So I worked quite a bit with different doctors, neurologists and so on during my PhD itself. I worked with leprosy patients. I was there in the hospital for 15 days with the patients. So that gave me a different kind of exposure. And he also asked us to develop hardware and software ourselves. Later on, you know, I continued the similar thing, but in an initial period of my life, I didn't get much funds for that. But towards the end, again, you know, neuroscience became this thing, and I got very good students. I came back to this thing. But even otherwise, my language technology also, as you've seen, I applied it towards more, you know, usage of people with certain individual challenges and so on. So basically, my this thing is all technologies should be used for human purpose, as you started this session with that quote from Einstein. Even as a theoretical scientist, he said that, but I'm an applied scientist, so I feel I should do that much more.
So your story is very inspiring, sir. That is, all your research are for the benefit for the common people. And we wish you all the best for your continued efforts in this journey.
Thank you so much.